And then I realized, oh, there's a guy who's bringing donuts to the manager of the store so that he can get shelf space and compete against other people to have shelf space, whether it's loaves of bread or whatever it is. And I never, Roger, that was a newsflash to me. Like
this stuff just doesn't show up.
Hello and welcome to episode 19 of the Life Insurance Academy podcast. I'm your host, Austin Lopes-Severo, and I'm here with Chris Ball, Zach McElwain, and Roger Short. The LIA podcast takes you into the conversations of top-producing life insurance agents so that you can level up your business. For episode notes and resources, visit liapodcast.org and follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at LifeInsureCAD. Also, make sure to subscribe to our text notifications for episode releases and agent resources. All you have to do is send the letters LIA to the number 82149. That's 82149 in a message with the letters LIA. Thanks for joining us today. Over the past six episodes, we've taken a deep dive into making the transition from face-to-face life insurance sales to telesales due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Well, today we find ourselves, like most Americans, in yet another transition, getting back to the quote, normal of work. Now, the thing is, many people don't have a normal that they can go back to, or for some, maybe even a job, which leaves them wondering, what now? So, guys, what now?
Yeah, it's going to be weird getting back, but I do think there are people trying to figure out what the heck to do. I know people who have been laid off or furloughed, and they're trying to, are they going back to a job? They don't know. Are they looking for a new career option? And that's really kind of what we're talking about today, is those people who are kind of looking into the wild blue yonder, trying to figure out what their next steps are.
I think the desire to go out and find ways to create income opportunities is born out of necessity, is born out of a change, is born out of something, a catalyst.
A crisis.
A crisis that pushes you to look at things differently than the way you have been before. It forces you to look at things. There's people out there trying to make it in business right now, and they've had three or four accounts, but because of this pandemic, those accounts have gone away. Now what? There's people who had jobs in auto manufacturing, and the car plants have been shut down for 2.5 months. They're just now starting to reopen. A lot of those temp workers that were hoping to get on there, they still don't know if they're going to get hired back because of how things have changed. So it makes people look at what's happening. For me, when I came out of sheer need to make more money to support my family because we wanted to have kids, I took on side jobs. I took on a job selling carpet at a flooring store, when we were first married, because I just needed to make more money. In addition to that, I got involved in an MLM way back in the day, and that taught me to get out there and hustle. I learned some very good principles in those 3 or 4 years while I was doing that, chasing that dream that seemed to always be, farther and farther away. The closer you try to get to it, it just seemed farther and farther away, because most of it, we're selling people on an idea that they could have something without a lot of the work. And most people got in on the idea, but then didn't do the work. And so I was busting it. Yeah, we made some money, but the principles I learned out of that were just, you got to go after it. And it's okay to work at night. It's okay to work at night. I wrote 4 applications last night.
Last night,
between 6:30 and 10:30, over $4,200 in premium last night. That was after work. Most people are gone home. Like, there's opportunity everywhere. You just got to seize it. You got to look for it and go after it. And so the catalyst that crisis brings, if you're listening to this podcast and you're asking yourself the question, first of all, why are you listening to this podcast? You're looking for something. You're looking for more information. You found this dialogue or this crazy group of guys to be fun to listen to for some unknown reason. Or you're looking for information of what to do with your life or to improve your existing life insurance career. Maybe you're considering a life insurance career. You're listening to a bunch of guys who had catalysts that moved them to look at other opportunities, and now they find themselves here in one of the best industries in the world. All kinds of different personalities. I think a lot of people, even if you go all the way back to high school, do people think about life insurance sales as a career opportunity? It's never taught. It's never talked about. I mean, sales in general, I think, is not really talked about a lot. Most people focus on education, your degree, your master's, your career track, you know, industries. Sales makes the world go round. Like, there are no engineers unless something's being sold somewhere.
Yeah.
Someone has to sell something in order for the engineer to have a job, mm-hmm. right? So regardless of what it is, the economy, this world of commerce that we're in, that we're trying to get restarted right now, restart this economy, is driven by sales, one business to another, meeting a need. And so it's not talked about. The whole idea of sales careers and sales industries, I don't think it's focused enough on, because it's such a diverse landscape. It's hard to narrow down what skill set do you actually need.
It's funny. I've never knew that. I never considered that. I'd go to the store and buy stuff off the shelf and never really considered how the heck it got there.
Yeah.
You know, and until I started doing sales, and then I realized, oh, there's a guy who's bringing donuts to the manager of the store so that he can get shelf space and compete against other people to have shelf space, whether it's loaves of bread or whatever it is. And I never, Roger, that was a newsflash to me. Like this stuff just doesn't show up.
Yeah. Like Tyson, the meat packing company, I mean, they're one of the biggest. They have salespeople. And those salespeople sell to major chains, outlets, small grocery outlets all over the country and probably all over the world. And they have frontline people. And without them getting those contracts to put their meat products in those stores, people don't buy it. So it's a distribution chain, right? We talk about the whole distribution chain being interrupted during this time. Those salespeople on the front line are the first point of contact. If that doesn't happen, everybody else is impacted behind it. So sales as a career is an enormous opportunity because it can go in so many directions. And of course, we find ourselves here in life sales, which I think is one of the best. So that's just me personally, though. I'm biased.
There was a famous line during the housing crisis by, you know, whether you like him or not, this was an interesting line that always kind of stuck in my head, was Rahm Emanuel. I don't know if you remember that. He said, never let a good crisis go to waste.
Yeah.
There were some political things attached to that, and that'll probably get edited out of the podcast. <I'm just
laughs> I don't know about.
There's no opinions. There's no opinions about the statement, but this is the thing.
You said it in a previous podcast, so, you know, at this point, it's just like, well, we have it on tape multiple times.
Okay, there we go. But this, you know, and we've talked about this as a group, like there's something interesting that happens. You said it's a blessing in disguise, you know.
That's the politically correct
way of saying that these things happen and it forces you to look at something through a different lens. And I know I had some, you know, thoughts about sales before I ever got into sales. I got in at the housing crisis, and it was because I was forced mm-hmm. to look into the wild blue yonder in a way and say, man, there's gotta be something more. I don't know about you, Austin, you know, your thoughts on sales. And I know
I think a question that a lot of people have, including myself, is like, I'm not an outgoing person. Can I even be in sales? Right? Like, what are the qualities, if any, that are requirements of sales, or maybe disqualifiers? Because my natural instinct is like, well, I'm not like super outgoing, so I wouldn't be good at sales because salespeople have to be outgoing. Like, I don't even know what a salesperson, what a good salesperson needs to be or have, you know? And I think, to Roger's point, we were never taught that. Like, sales is never really discussed, so people don't even know. There's just a lot of like unclarity, and so I think part of that is people stray away from what they don't know.
Yeah.
And they also don't know, so they don't go towards it, right? It's
100%, man.
So what are those things?
Yep. And I'll tell you some of the misconceptions I had on the front side. For me, it was I didn't understand sales. It just, you know, when I thought of sales, I thought of the checkered jacket, car sales guy, you know, where
they come over here, I got a sweet deal.
Yeah, yeah. Hey, kid, you know, psst, like I joke about that. But, you know, then you buy the car, you drive it off the lot and it falls apart. That's what you think of, or I thought of when I thought of sales, how to get in front of people. You know, how the heck do you get in front of people? That was a big question mark for me. And I felt kind of safe with my job. I never was required to go look or try to figure something out. But knowing that and being on that side of it, I do think there's some, I guess we would say, indicators of what you might be, you know, if it's a Jeff Foxworthy way of saying it, you might be a salesperson if.
Yeah.
Right? You know, he's like, what is it, the redneck thing? Is that what he's got going for him? If,
yeah.
Yeah, trademark Jeff Foxworthy, so he can sponsor us. I don't know if we want that one.
No, it's part of our budget. Now we have to pay Jeff Foxworthy. Yeah, great.
No, he's great. Paying us.
That's right.
He's sponsoring. No, he's not. He's not.
But I think one of the things that I would look for, I would say, is an indicator, is you have an eye for an opportunity. You have an eye for opportunity. That's probably a better way of saying it. And I think I was that person. I was always looking for, lack of a better word, a hustle. Mm-hmm. You know, I was looking for a hustle. And I still kind of do.
I think everybody is a salesman at some capacity. It's whether they tap into that or not. Like, my first perception of a salesman was, have you seen the movie Secondhand Lions with Robert Duvall?
Mm-mm. Chris?
Chris is our movie guy.
That's the Haley Joel Osment movie, right? He's the ghost kid from Sixth Sense. Yeah, yeah. Okay. Yes, I did see it.
The two older men, and they have the boy that comes in and to live with them. And, you know, all day long, all they do, they have all this money and they live on this farm. And all day long, these salesmen are pulling up in their fancy black cars, wearing their black suits and their briefcases, coming up, and they have their guns and scaring them, you know, shooting off and trying to scare them away. And it's just hilarious. So, I mean, that was my whole perception of salesmen. And I was like, man, that's something I'll never want to be. Just not at all. But understanding what sales really is, that it doesn't have to be that super outgoing, super flashy type of in-your-face generic smile. It can be a genuine person that's just trying to connect and help you. And that was a big differentiator for me, is understanding that. So when Austin talks about, you know, I don't know if I could be in sales, or I don't know if that's me because I'm a quiet person, or I'm not outgoing. Well, that's me. I'm more of an introverted person. I'm not that outgoing. And that was exactly my thoughts moving into a sales opportunity that I thought I would never be in.
But he's super competitive. Once you get to know Zach, he's super competitive. It's been demonstrated in every year of his life up till, you know, when he decided to make a career decision and go down a path. So yeah. All you had to do is look back at him. So yeah, maybe not really outgoing, you know, not the person to jump in and dance at the party, but competitive. So that's definitely a character trait. Do you have that competitive? Austin, I will tell you, I mean, there's technical sales. You'd be great at technical sales if you wanted to. I mean, my friend, I've got a friend, Trevor, from Canada. He works for an industrial racking company. They outfit all the large warehouse and distribution centers around Canada. And he sells racking to buyers. It's a technical sale. Oftentimes, he has an engineer with him while they're doing the transactions to propose the bids.
Oh, wow.
So it's a lot of custom technical specifications and then sourcing products and then beating a price. It's a very technical sales process. And so there's a skill set that goes behind that, but you're selling to a buyer. That's their job. Their title is the buyer, and their job is to source out products from the best source at the lowest prices. And so there's all kinds of sales industries. It's meeting a need that's in front of you.
Yeah, and the different people have different styles. Like, even in our organization, like, there's so many different styles in the home. Like, when you just look at us in here, like, Chris, you know, you talking to a client or you presenting anything is completely different than me, which is also completely different, Roger. And our styles are different, but we're all accomplishing the same goal and meeting the same needs.
I do think it's cool that we do have successful introverts and we have successful extroverts.
Yep.
It just manifests itself differently with the client. And that's why I felt like it was important to talk about some of these identifiers. One being having an eye for opportunity.
Mm-hmm. For me, I was always looking to make a quick dollar. And I learned that, I learned early, I guess, in even when I was back in college, like I was looking for the way to make the most money in the shortest period of time that didn't require a lot of effort. It just required a focused effort for a short period. And if I could make a good return on that, so I always saw that. Like we would drive an hour and a half when I was in college on Friday nights. We would drive an hour and a half to a trucking center across Toronto. We were northeast of Toronto. We would drive back down to the 401 all the way across, go up to Brampton, Ontario, and go to a trucking center. And we would unload and load trucks all night. But it was one of the highest paid jobs that we could find. But we used to make an hour and a half drive. And it was so good that I ended up, there was five people that I got jobs there. And we would drive. And so there would be one poor sap driving home in the morning, dead tired. And the other guys would all be sleeping in the car. But we'd make a lot of money in one night. And we always had cash to spend. So I saw that. People say, you're crazy. Why do you drive that far? Because I make $250 on the weekend.
Yeah.
And what are you doing? You're like delivering Square Boy pizza for $5 an hour and a tip maybe.
Thin crust light sauce.
I think my eye out for opportunity was a little bit different. I wasn't traveling for money, but it wasn't to get the quick buck. It really wasn't to make a quick return like Roger, the Derby horse over here, the thoroughbred. Let me race for 2 minutes, make a lot of money.
That was in high school. That's how I started.
Yeah.
Obviously,
yeah.
That's developed quite a bit.
Mine's a little, mine was different though. Like I didn't want the quick money. I just wanted what I was worth. And I wanted to be able to make it on my own without having to depend on somebody or wait on somebody. And my first few jobs that I had, and I worked multiple jobs while I was in college, I would just be burning inside every single day to know that, you know, these three or four people that were working with me were making more money than me. And we were all making small dollar amounts at that time anyways. But if they made $1.25 more than me, it burned me up because I did 10 times the work they did. I was 10 times more respectful, my quality of work, speed of work, seriousness, every aspect, I was blowing them out the water. And that goes back to my competitiveness that Roger talked about. You know, I've been in sports my entire life, and everything I want to do, I want to be the best and I want to win or don't even do it. I mean, that's just kind of my mentality. And like, even if it's a simple hourly job, I'm going to outwork everybody. But I got so mad that they would just sit there and not do anything, or they would boss me around or wouldn't have to do it because they had seniority, or they were there 3 months longer and got hired before I did.
If you're trapped in one of those types of jobs and you feel frustrated with the seniority or the union or the, you know, you're in a career where you can only move up if someone else moves out, and you can't, you know, if that's one of the things that burns you up, that's a trait. That's one of those traits.
100%. Like, I just wanted to be free.
Hate having a boss.
That's the point, because the boss is a dude that's probably been there a little bit longer but doesn't know half the stuff you do. I mean, I was in that exact situation. Like, our manager sitting in the office not doing anything, just chain smoking cigarettes. And like, it's like, you got to be kidding me, man. And I just wanted to be set free. I wanted to know that, man, if I wanted to go out and make as much money as I wanted to, if I find something on the internet that I want to buy, I want to know I can bust butt for 2 days and go buy it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I don't want to have to plan, well, if I know I make this much this week, I get paid every 2 weeks, I can buy that in 6 weeks from now as long as I don't have any sick days. I don't want that, man.
Or as long as I don't have a tire repair that I need to make or something. You know what I mean?
It's, like it's awful. Like, I just wanted to be set free and know that I have nobody else to blame for my income. Nobody. Like, I can't point the finger and say, well, you know, I didn't do a good job. Like, if I want to make money, I'll make money. If I don't, then I won't. I can't be mad that I didn't make money because I have nobody to look at. I didn't say I didn't get that promotion, or he never gave me the raise, or he got the good route to go run the job on and I got the bad route. Like, it's nobody's fault. It's mine. And I wanted that responsibility.
Hey there, it's Austin. We're going to end this part of the podcast recording there, but the episode isn't over. You see, we want to take you behind the scenes to share some of the interesting dialogue we had during a break. Now, this discussion had some passionate moments, but we think many people who are trying to figure out what's next can relate. It may sound a little different than what we normally do or what our long-term listeners are used to, but again, This would have been an outtake. To set this up, we are about to dive into the point that sales may be a good option for you if you have transferable skills. But what if you don't think your existing skills could transfer to this opportunity? Let's listen in.
We haven't covered that piece.
The question is, how do I know it's for me? And we had identified some identifiers. The three big identifiers that I had for this episode is, do you have an eye for opportunity? Do you have transferable skills? Are you tired of having a ceiling put on you? Those are the three. Those are the three.
I didn't have any skills, Chris. I didn't have any transferable skills.
See, but that's part of the question. So the questions here are transferable skills. What were some? Does everyone have them? Does everyone have transferable skills? What are some out-of-the-box transferable skills? Like, have you really thought about it, of the work that you've done? There was customer service. There was generating sales. I mean, you had to go knock on doors and get, like, how the heck did you mow a lawn? Did you just randomly start mowing the strip down the middle of your neighborhood? No.
It was the worst thing, you know. Do you need your grass cut?
Yeah, well, that's exactly it.
But you did it.
So,
where Roger Short would have been like, hey, how you doing? I like your dog. Your dog's beautiful. What kind of fertilizer do you use? I like those plants. I got to come back. Let me get some extra plants.
Let me show you my yard. Here's some pictures. You want a yard that looks like this? I can get started right now.
But what I'm saying is, I didn't start with all that stuff. Right. My personality was completely different.
Right. But it was transferable. It was a seed.
I didn't get that ability until after I was already here.
Yeah.
He had them. He had the work ethic. Right?
Is that a skill, though?
Well, when we say a transferable skill,
that's a drive. That's a mindset. Like,
yeah, but if you're talking to an audience, you know, do you have a strong work ethic? Is that you? Because if I'm listening to this podcast, I'm going to go, yeah, that's me. I have that. I look for opportunities.
There are qualities that can be transferred from one job to another.
We can say qualities instead of skills, so he's not confused by that.
Well, maybe you could say that definition on there, but that would be it. Like, right. I didn't have the gift of to talk or to persuade.
Here's the thing, dude. And I don't even mind this being on the podcast, but here's the thing. This debate is fine because you're thinking, I think a lot of people are doing exactly what you do. Like,
that's my point I'm trying to get
this
across.
This is great for the podcast.
Yes.
This stuff right now.
Yeah. You're dismissing the fact that you knocked on a door and you whispered to Mrs. Jones that you wanted to cut her grass. You wouldn't be doing this if you didn't do that.
To be honest, the majority of the yards I maintained at that young age, I didn't even go see them. I would just perfect my work, and they would come to me. To be honest, because I wouldn't.
How did you get the first one, Zach?
My grandma.
Okay. And then what?
It was the quality.
And then you worked. So no, here's another transferable skill set.
They came to me based upon that.
Here's another transferable skill set. Attention to detail. And excellent work.
That's it right there.
Right, but that's not a skill set that I would have known. This is what I'm trying to say. Like,
but it's one you had.
Okay.
Well, it's important.
You just said you developed most of your lawns because people would see how good the work was and they'd come to you.
Right.
And then you realized this is an asset.
Yeah,
that's being a perfectionist. That's a transferable asset.
Right, but what I'm saying is, if I'm in the car riding and saying, am I right for life sales? Do I have these skills? I would have said no. I'm still saying no. Like, that's a quality that I have, but I wouldn't consider that, even though it is, I wouldn't consider that a transferable skill.
Yeah, and maybe the word skill is not the right word. It's an asset,
that's
a
fine.
Quality,
we'll say transferable.
It's a trait.
Yeah,
it's an innate thing that's in you, and you've learned. So when you started developing, when you started working in that, so two things happened. You had a crisis. You leaned into opportunity. You look for ways to make money. This was one of them. You started doing it. You did it very well. The better you did it, the more attention you got. That reinforced the idea then quality work gets more work, right? And you started understanding how you can do that. Then you went from a push mower to a ride-on probably, right?
Well, I went from a push mower and only cutting my grandma's grass and a few neighbors close to buying little mowers and putting them at other people's houses, convincing somebody to drop me off to cut their grass, to eventually getting my license and then a trailer and a commercial size mower.
So you kept the progression going because you saw opportunity and you kept chasing the opportunity. So that drive, personal drive, work ethic, commitment to excellence, quality, like having an opportunity to go out and earn money on the weekend when other people were doing nothing, sleeping in. You were taking advantage of all those things. Those are all transferable skill sets into this industry.
I agree.
Here's
I guess one of my biggest differences is that wasn't like a everybody could have that. Everybody.
Right.
But everybody can't have an outgoing personality or right. talent or well, those things.
This is from Indeed, okay? Indeed.com's definition of transferable skills. Any skills you possess that would be useful to an employer, okay? So transferable skills, communication, dependability, teamwork, organization, adaptability, leadership. That was our initial conversation, was the leadership conversation. And even on the front side of that, I did not see how in the world talking to kids about, you know, the Bible or helping leaders talk to kids about the Bible, I did not have a clue on what how that would work knocking on the door and trying to sell a policy. It didn't make any sense to me at all. Mm-hmm. So I had a transferable block, you know, of seeing how that works. It's
funny that you say that, Chris, because I wouldn't have been able to even talk to kids where you it was easy for you and you're trying to make the leap to insurance. That was the block for me, was to talking to anybody yeah. that I don't know.
I think that's a personality issue. And right. personalities are, you know, there's 1,000 different personalities. So Chris's personality was a fun guy who liked to make people laugh. And that's how he got to people to like him, to tell the joke and to have people laugh at his jokes. And he'd have his go-to lines. And he still does. He still does. So that was comfortable for him to do that, right? It was comfortable for him to hang out and to relax.
Well, relational. I'm a relational yeah. person. I feel weird. I mean, this corona thing's miserable, man. Like, I need to put my hand on somebody's
nope,
shoulder.
Not,
I
know, not yet. I know not yet.
Bad Chris.
And we're all 6 feet apart still, even in this podcast studio. Are. But so, like, when if you guys were to ask me, right? So you know how this company started and how we started this business. But if you guys were to ask me, if we had to identify somebody as a quality candidate who would be one of our number one contributors in the industry, and I described a guy who was a youth pastor in junior high ministry, never sold anything in his life, would you immediately think that guy had transferable skills? If I were to identify a young guy who didn't like to be outgoing at all, was super quiet, and didn't have any career experience in sales, Chris, what do you think? Should we take a chance on that guy and invest?
On paper, I think I'd be a little nervous.
Right?
Yeah.
Right? So both of you guys on paper yeah. don't line up. They right. don't line up.
Right.
They don't line up. And so most people, if you're listening to this thing, you have to look inside, because it's not the ability to convince somebody to do something they don't want to do. That's not what this is.
Right there.
Yeah, and so that's the barrier that most people have. Like, I don't want to be that guy who's pushing products. That's not what we're doing. Like, we help people. We bless people. We take care of people's families. I feel like we are blessing lives when we help people put policies in place, because I know that, you know, I'm protecting their family. It makes me feel good. When you look inside at your own skill set, most people dismiss their qualities. And like Zach would dismiss it. Zach, you probably had fears and apprehensions when you looked at this. In fact, I remember the time you actually turned me down on the first go.
You're talking about what it looks like on paper for me, what this opportunity looked on, or, you know, as far as you all looking as me as a candidate. When I looked at this opportunity, I was like, I don't want to do anything traveling or anything else at all. Because, you know, you know, I was a marketing major, business management. I loved business, and I understood that
he wanted a job.
The whole world, yeah, yeah. And so it's that fear. That fear handicaps you, because you don't ever want to be in a position that you're not making it. You're not good enough. Or for me personally, that I'm not winning.
What's the unknown?
But here, that's the thing. The one thing that keeps you in the fear is you'll always have that fear. You can never escape that. And just thinking of it, like, I turned you down. I said no. And I've known you for years, Roger, and the only reason I even showed up in an interview is because I knew you were successful. I didn't even know what you did. I didn't even know it was life insurance. I had no idea. I just knew it with the way I was personally and my, quote, transferable skills that I now know I had when I didn't know I had them, which would have been, yeah. you know, dependability, work ethic, you know, competitiveness. I knew I was going to be really good at no matter what I did, just because it's almost crazy, but I would just consume myself with mastering it, whatever it was, putting the time in. And when I was looking at that, I knew I'd be good. I didn't know what it was. He's like, hey, it's, you know, it's insurance, it's sales, and it's traveling. I'm like, oh, wonderful. And, you know, I talked about it. And I had a wedding coming up that was only 2 months away from this, and we're going to be 100% commission. I would be leaving three different jobs that I had income on, still managing my own lawn care, and I was working two jobs, one day and one night, and doing the lawn care on the weekends. And I knew exactly how much money I was going to make to pay for this wedding. I knew how long it was going to take me. I mean, everything was lined out, and it was so predictable. I didn't like the freedom. I told you guys about the feeling trapped in a job. Somebody's making $1.25 more than me, and they ain't worth a crap. You know, just frustrating me that I never could reach my potential. And I said, Roger, no. I turned it down because of fear. I didn't think I had any transferable skills. I wasn't the outgoing salesman. I didn't have sales experience. I've never sold anything. You know, I didn't know that was me. But I knew that I'm always a person that wanted to bet on myself. And so that's the only thing I had going into this. Like, Roger, you talk about transferable skills, dependability, hard work, being a perfectionist, quality of work, all of those things. Looking for opportunity. In my mind, I didn't think that was me. I've never sat down and wrote that down and figured that out. But I knew I wanted to bet on me, and my future was not going to be working those jobs and being under a boss that, you know, just wasn't, you know, just that was not me. I needed to be set free, and I knew I could do great things.
Sounds like there's a third piece to this. What's that third one? You don't want a ceiling. You didn't want a ceiling.
Oh, 100%. Like, that's what I'm saying. That
you
free,
wanted an opportunity, you know, that you were in control of.
I'm an eagle. I needed to soar, you know.
And you spread your wings, buddy.
He didn't
terrible.
Know he was an eagle.
Yeah. It was
just an eaglet.
Is that a thing? I told myself
I think so.
That.
Eaglet?
I think that's the thing on the end of a tennis shoe. Shoelace.
I think it is.
It's or called
is
it, an eaglet?
I believe so.
No.
Fact check me. Fact check
me. We got to look that up.
It's one of them jokes that just sucks the air out of the tire.
Golly.
He didn't know he was an eagle, but he was. He was an eagle down on the ground with the chickens, wondering how those eagles are soaring and why the rest of the chickens are happy to keep pecking at that dirt.
I knew I'd have eagle effort. That's all that mattered. And I told myself, no matter what, I would give myself a year of giving it everything I got. I wouldn't question myself a weekend. I wouldn't question myself 6 months in. It had to be a full year of full effort, or you're cheating yourself from the beginning. You might as well not start. Like I said, my personality is all or nothing.
I think these indicators, the cool thing is, in our conversation, I feel like it's been cool to hear the passion from kind of each one of us on this, you know, about looking for opportunity or having an eye for it, about transfer, you know, some of the things we had in our previous jobs, some of them we liked and some of them we hated, you know, but we didn't realize, man, we had this massive, tool belt of experience that we could bring into something like this. And then lastly, Zach, I think you spoke with a lot of conviction about having a ceiling put on you, whether it's the position or whether it's the people in the position, you know, like you're sitting in a break room and these guys can't get out to go back to work and you're getting paid the same amount as those guys, like
less.
Yeah. And so it's interesting to hear the passion around those things. And this really is the podcast. I know there are a lot of agents who are listening who are in sales, but I know that people are questioning today what's going on in their lives, what's going on in this planet. And wondering, man, can I take this ceiling off? Do I have what it takes?
Yeah. You got to push through that fear. Zach said you never get over the fear. Yeah.
And that's what I mean.
The way you can break through it is the way you can overcome it, it never really goes away. But the only way for you to realize your potential is to push through in the face of fear. And to lean on those things that you know that you are capable of doing. So there's control factors that we all kind of have that, okay, I know I'm capable of doing this. And if I get good at this piece, I can push through that fear and I can reinvent myself, right? We talked, maybe it was last week, we said necessity is the mother of invention, right? And so because of the crisis, because of who you are, because you want to have more, to do more, to not be stuck, to have an unlimited opportunity, all these things, you know, and especially right now, people are looking inward and they're looking outward. And that introflection and then looking out at other opportunities makes you question, but don't let the fear stop you from saying, hey, my skill sets can transfer. I have these traits that these guys are talking about, and this can be a skill set. Out of necessity, a lot of things can happen. Look inward at your own characteristics. You may not be in sales now. Do you have those skill sets that we've identified? Those are transferable skill sets into this industry. This is an industry of helping people. The sales process can be taught. It can be learned. The rest is work ethic and drive and a passion for excellence and doing great work. And not having that ceiling put on you, and then a strive to be number one. That's why we have top producers every week, and our top producers get irked when they're not in that top five or top 10 or in top position, and it bugs them. I think we all kind of have that trait.
Yeah, I think so.
I know it gets in your craw when you commit to something, like you're all in on that.
Yeah.
Yes. Yep. I've seen it happen.
I say the biggest thing is, if you're listening to this, and you can say to yourself, or you can ask yourself, am I getting paid what I'm actually worth? Mm-hmm. And if that answer is no, then you're trapped. You know, you'll never be satisfied where you're at because you know the quality. And that's exactly where I was. No sales experience, never thought about sales myself, but I knew that this industry would bring and free all those other opportunities. Sales is just a simple byproduct. That stuff can be taught, but what can't be taught is that hunger, that desire to be worth something to yourself.
And that's a wrap for today's show and the behind-the-scenes exclusive. If you feel like you have an eye for opportunity, transferable skills, and are tired of having a ceiling being put on you, reach out. You can visit liapodcast.org/EP19. That's liapodcast.org/EP19 for more information on the opportunity or to ask us questions. And also make sure to check out some of our other episodes, including episode 1. To our existing agents, maybe you have a friend who's wondering what's next. Share this podcast with them. Furthermore, maybe you personally feel like you still have a ceiling. Well, there's better opportunities out there for you, and we're happy to connect you with them. Send us a message on social media or through the website at liapodcast.org/EP19 or /feedback. We'd love to hear what you think. As always, thanks so much for listening to the Life Insurance Academy podcast. If you enjoyed this podcast, make sure to subscribe wherever you're listening, rate us 5 stars, and follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at Life Insure Acad. This episode of the Life Insurance Academy podcast was produced by Chris Ball and me, Austin Lopes-Overo. I also mixed this episode. Our theme song is by Flashing Lights. We hope to connect with you soon. Until next episode, stay healthy and go be a difference maker.